At the outset, I would like to express my gratitude and warm welcome to Chief Guest Dr. Sajidanand Joshi, Member Secretary IGNC. Professor Joshi is a great scholar of history and mass communication, as well as he is a writer, a poet, and an actor. He was the founder vice chancellor of Kushobhai Thackeray University of Journalism and Mass Communication, Raipur. He served as vice chancellor of two terms, that's 10 years. He was also the founder registrar of Makhanlal Chaturvedi National University of Journalism and Mass Communication, Bhopal. And later he served as dean academics in that institution too. He has written extensively on media communication, history, culture, education, policy, and other relevant issues. He has been delivering lectures on communication, gender sanitization, research and resurgence, personality development, art and culture in prestigious institutions. He has edited the speeches of Honorable Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi ji for publication division. He edited many other prestigious publications. Some of his recent published works include Sachidanand Joshi ki Lokpriya Kahaniyan, Kuch Alp Viram, Pal Bhar ki Pehchan. These two are poetry collections. His speech have been compiled into volumes titled Mera Desh Mera Dar.
Thank you very much, Professor Malla, Honorable Dr. Colonel K. Prasad, Dr. Devendra Barua, Dr. Om Prakash Kumar, Dr. Sachin Tiwari, Dr. Debashish Garanayak, and my colleagues at IGNCA, Rock Art Division colleagues, and other colleagues from different divisions, and the distinguished participants who have gathered to join this important webinar on rock art of Eastern India. We know that IGNCA has started a separate division known as Rock Art just to make aware the larger group of people, intellectual community, scholars, about the importance of rock art and the need to study rock art in a separate stream or separate dimension. I know students belonging to archaeology or students belonging to anthropology were studying rock art as a part of their studies. And in fact, there has been some very important excavations during that. But to develop rock art as an independent discipline, as a specialized discipline, has been the initiative of IGNCA. And the rock art division of IGNCA is dedicated to the father of Indian rock art, Sri V.S. Vakankar ji, Haribhau Vakankar ji, who has contributed tremendously as far as the excavations of rock arts is concerned in India. We know that his find of Bhimetka has been a path-breaking find, and it has really recreated, and it has prompted the historians and archaeologists to rethink about India's origin and India's ancestral past, because the Bhimbetka caves deals with the prehistoric era, and they claim that they belong to 10 to 15,000 years back, which is a remarkable achievement as far as Indian archaeological excavation is concerned. After that, it was also realized that the rock art treasures spread throughout the country must not only be identified and researched, but also enough awareness should be generated among the scholars to go deep into the study of rock arts, because rock arts are not only the kind of paintings or a piece of art which have to be studied and seen only as a piece of art and expression, but also it should be studied as a part of the civilizational studies, the ethnographic studies, and cultural studies. What kind of heritage, what kind of culture, what kind of lineage, what kind of customs, what kind of traditions we had. And that is why the rock art division at IGNCA is trying to build up an entirely different narrative as far as rock art studies is concerned. We were also trying to build awareness among the institutions, especially when children are there in their college to study and to have some kind of an interest to study the rock art, because only studying history is not going to create interest. Students must be made aware related to the treasure of rock arts in different parts of the country. India is fortunate to have one of the richest treasures of rock art in the world. I'm sure the expert would correct me if I am wrong, but it has one of the richest treasures of the rock arts in the world. And only because awareness was not there, or only because there was no effort, categorized effort or organized effort, we lost a substantial part of rock art treasure in India. But now, since the awareness has been generated, now since efforts are being made, we are also trying to make a rock art society so that more and more youngsters and scholars come and join together. There would be an effort so that we can strike with a combination of all experienced, knowledge scholars along with some youngsters who have studied either archaeology or anthropology or history. They can come, they can combine, they can make a very good project team and try going to the sites which have not been explored so far. I am happy that this time our rock art division has identified the Eastern India for this webinar. And Eastern India has been a land of rich cultural heritage, we all know. Especially, I don't know whether Northeast is also covered in this or not, but even if only eastern part is covered, may it be Bengal, may it be Odisha, may it be Bihar, they all are rich as far as rock art is concerned. And I'm happy that scholars belonging to BHU, scholars belonging to Bhubaneswar, Odisha University, or scholars like Colonel A.K. Prasad, who is a rock art expert of Bihar and Jharkhand, They would be throwing light on these aspects, and it is going to be an interesting webinar, I'm sure, and it is going to be a path-breaking seminar. Why I'm saying path-breaking? Because I see many youngsters joining this webinar. The number of participants is touching 200, which is an encouraging number, I must say, as far as rock art studies is concerned. So many youngsters who have joined this webinar would also be taking it up as their future course of study, and maybe we will have a new, entirely new dimension as far as the rock art treasure in Eastern India is concerned. I must also point out that the rapid construction activity, especially in the urban areas, is also creating some kind of a threat to the rock art treasure. We must also make people aware of that, because when the blasting is done, they do not see what kind of rock is there and what kind of depiction is there on the rocks, and blasting is done. So we are also trying to sort of make aware the governments that before giving the permission for the blasting, there can be some kind of a cross check whether there is some rock art treasure available in that blast in the area where the blasting is going to take place. I'm sure that expert would also throw some light on this aspect, because that is to conserve our rock art heritage for the posterity, for the future generations. Under the able leadership of Professor B.L. Malla, who is an eminent expert of rock art, internationally acclaimed expert, IGNCA's rock art division is bringing out very, very, very knowledgeable, very nice publications and very nice reports. We are doing some important projects. We have already done some very important projects in Western India, and we are also doing some important projects in Eastern India as well. So the participants would also be learning a lot when Professor Malla tells you about our projects which are being undertaken by the IGNCA. And I once again welcome all the distinguished speakers of this webinar. I wish every success to this webinar, and I would also request that this webinar should not become only a ritualistic one, but we should come out with some concrete action plan which can be followed in future for studies and for bringing out some kind of a systematic stream of knowledge in front of the academic arena. I must congratulate Professor Malla and his entire team for putting up this show, and my best wishes to all. Thank you very much. Namaskar.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for always giving encouragements to the team and the division, and also for your guidance, ever guidance. So thank you very much, sir. So now we will start then the academic session. So I would like to introduce the seminar. In fact, we have been doing the seminars internationally, national seminars, and the seminars at different levels. So the main aim of doing these seminars, workshops, is just to keep all the scholars, interested scholars, and the budding scholars updated with the rock art research throughout recent trends in rock art research globally. So that is through the international seminars we are trying to achieve that. And at the national level, we do the seminar just to have the national scenario of rock art and its allied subjects, just that so that people can know about this rich cultural heritage which is emerging in India as a research field. And in this field, we are trying to do the multidisciplinary research. And I must say that I must take it as a proud and congratulate our Honorable Member Secretary for that. We are doing the multidisciplinary research, and we have the multidisciplinary teams throughout the India. At least in 16 states, we have created the multidisciplinary teams which are doing research and documentation, and the research projects which are coming out of that are already either in the process of publication or have been published and will be published throughout all the states. We are doing this type of exercise wherever that we have the rock art concentration. So we have also started to have the seminars at the regional levels also, because the reason is that we have the regional peculiarities, regional flavor to all the forms of arts also. So the same thing which see in the rock art also. So when we see the depictions, it is maybe the depiction will be the same everywhere, but from the interpretation point of view, we have sometimes the different interpretation in a different context. So by doing these type of regional seminars, we are coming out with new interpretations and multifaceted interpretations also. So far we have done the seminar on rock art of Central India, rock art of South India, now rock art of Eastern India we will be doing this time. So for this seminar, we have selected, we are assembled here the scholars, young and the experienced. As our Honorable Member Secretary was saying, that after seeing the young generation, it is always good to see people in the rock art field where we have very less interested people. But at least I must tell, sir, that we have tried to develop the teams of young and the experienced people everywhere. And we have created the interest at the university and university college levels and at the administrative levels to all the people also. So these are the things which I would like to say before I start this webinar. So let us, I will not take more time because we have many people. I would like to listen to them and come out with the proceedings, fruitful proceedings. So first of all, I would like to call Dr.
T.B. Gannaik, who will be talking on the raw art of Orissa. So Dr. D.B. Gannaik is presently, in the meantime, I would like to give brief about all the scholars before their presentation. In the meantime, they must share their screen. So may I request Dr. Gannaik to start sharing his screen, and is presently working as superintendent archaeologist ASI Meerut Circle, Uttar Pradesh. Before this, he has served as assistant professor in Asmara University and associate professor in Ethiopia. He has published more than a dozen of research papers in various national and international journals. He also authored monographs entitled Early Historic Archaeology of Orissa, Rock Art in Coastal Orissa, Prehistoric Art in Orissa, and edited a book on rock art in India. May I request Dr. Gannaik to start his presentation, and may please confine your presentation to 15 to 17 minutes, please.
Respected chairs and respected Professor Malla and Ekprasad sir, Beuria sir, and my friends. I just give thankful to IGNCA to give me opportunity to say something about Orissan rock art. As already Professor Mallab just give a brief introduction about me, I'm intimating all my friends that in 2006, for the first time, I was associated with IGNCA and doing a documentation project on Orissan rock art with Professor Malla at the end with Professor Pradhan. And they gave me a lot of opportunity to deal with the subject, to handle the subject properly and to understand the subject, how to deal the subject, how to understand the subject, how to carry forward the subject. And at last, I just confined to rock art study as my passions and my research, and I did my PhD also on prehistoric art. And as already mentioned, that I have written three books on rock art of Orissa particularly, and edited with my teachers, Professor Pradhan, a rock art art of India. Thanks, Professor Malla. I'm going to give a brief description about Orissan rock art. As you say, Orissa found its place in the rock art map of India in 1933, after K.P. Jaiswal reported the rock engravings in Vikramkhol, in the district of Jharsuguda, erstwhile of Sambalpur district of Orissa. After K.P. Jaiswal, lot of scholars like Professor Pradhan, P.K. Behera, Erwin Neumer, Arkhit Pradhan, and one of my friend Kunja Bihari Barik, we have documented about 106 shelters in different area of Orissa. Presently, we have already documented more than 120 shelters located in different geographical location of Orissa. The most number of concentration of rock art sites, as you see in the screen, that most of the sites are confined to western part of Orissa, basically Sambalpur, Jharsuguda, Sundargarh districts. In the process of exploration every year, new sites are come to the pictures. And presently, we have reached more than 120 sites in different districts of Orissa. As you know, that Orissa, there is a uniqueness of Orissa that here we found most of the art are non-thematic depiction. The subject matter of non-thematic, then in comparison to thematic depiction, as you see in the Central India. And in Orissa, there's a particular, there is a peculiarity in Orissa that both pictographs and petroglyphs are go hand in hand, being complementary to each other. By and large, the subject matters are same. If you see this map, you can see in the western part, there's more concentration of the rock art sites, basically in the Sundargarh region, than in Bargarh and in Sambalpur districts. And you find in some rock art shelters in the coastal area, just near the Cuttack and Khurda districts. And few sites have been found in the northern area, in Moyurbhanj districts, and some in the western northwestern in the western part in the Kalahandi districts. As a whole, when you see the geographical distribution of rock art sites in Orissa, Basically, we have similar type of rock art sites in the all the Mahanadi Valley. The similar type of distribution you can see from the eastern Bindhyan region up to Chotnagpur Plateau and in the western part up to Godavari Valley. In this region, from Chotnagpur Plateau to Godavari in the south, in the west from the Bindhyan, eastern Bindhyan region up to the coastal plain, in the district Cuttack, we have similar type of rock art distribution, both paintings as well as engravings. And those engravings are mostly pigmented engravings. In the subject matters, we find both animate and inanimate patterns. Inanimate, basically we find human forms and animal forms. In human form, there is very less number of human forms we found in Odishan rock art in comparison to animates. Like you can see deers, more are deers, elephant, and other herbivorous animals are, you can see, depicted in the rock art sites. And in comparison to non-thematics, this outnumber, 90% subject matters are non-thematic or geometric patterns executed in the rock art of Odisha. These are like symbolic, they're symbolic representations. And the recent discovery said that this in 2017-18 in periods, we found new rock art sites in the coastal Odisha, basically in the Chandaka, very close to Bhubaneswar. It is 30 kilometers away from Bhubaneswar. There are host of more than 32 shelters have recently found out by myself and my teams when I was working in Archaeological Survey of India in excavation branch. We take this project that why not in the coastal Odisha. And we are inspired by Professor Pradhan, who first discovered and identified rock engravings in Hathi Gumpha shelters. In Hathi Gumpha, rock cut caves of Hathi Gumpha was dated to 1st century BC. The rock cut caves are dated to 1st century BC assigned to King Kharavela. Within these caves, he noticed some obliterated form of rock art. And that is the turning point in the finding out of the rock art site in the coastal Odisha. After this, the expedition was going on and we find out 32 shelters. After 32, we find 12 shelters having both paintings and engravings. And if you see the distribution or the subject matter of these shelters, as everybody knows, Sundargarh district is very rich in paintings, while as in Sambalpur district in the middle Mahanadi Valley, you can say the middle Mahanadi Valley, the subject matters are mostly abstract patterns and executed in engravings. We don't have that much of paintings in comparison to Sundargarh districts, exclusively engravings. There are about more than 40 sites having engraving or pigment and engravings, and we have only two sites having paintings or two or three motifs of paintings of mat patterns. But when you come down towards to the coastal belt in the same river valley, this is uniqueness. This in the end of this Bindhyan land formation, you can say this Gondwana land formation was found in the Cuttack district, in the Khuda district. And in these shelters, we found both paintings and engravings. As if the both the communities, those who are responsible for paintings in west in the Sundargarh district or in the upper Mahanadi Valley, or those who are responsible for the engravings, they're executing their arts in the middle Mahanadi Valley, come together, and there is a cultural amalgamation. Maybe there is a cultural amalgamation between the this upper and middle valley, and you found in a composite form in the coastal Odisha. And another interesting features that before we don't have any evidence, then there's a in northern Odisha, in particularly in Moyurbhanj districts, in 2018 we discovered one area. Actually, there's not a shelters in boulders, in small granite boulders, we found cuff marks. And locally, these cuff marks are known as Bhimo Antu. This Antu matlab ghutno. जैसे घुटना बोलते हैं लोगों ने घुटना से भीम ने उसको दबा दिया है एंड दिस इज द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ द पीपल्स ऑफ द लोकेलिटीज एंड वी फाउंड सच टाइप ऑफ बोल्डर्स इन मयूरभंज दिस इज इन घंटशिला एरिया and which is very unique. And these boulders are full with cuff marks and are associated with stone tools from Upper Paleolithic tools, and Mesolithic tools are evidently scattered in air around. This is a new features recently come out in Odisha. Before we have paintings, we have engravings. Even we have sites like Chormoda in the border of Western, in the border of Sundargarh and Chhattisgarh region. One shelter is Chormoda, where we found only exclusively this shelter is of the cuff marks or cupules, and the cupules having forms of vulva as the hallmark of Odishan rock art is the vulva always. It's a center of concentration, and such type of cuff marks are having with subject matter or some symbolic representation. But in Moirbhans, for the first time we found exclusively the cuff marks are arid, executed in boulders. And people say very strong beliefs about this. Like in California, if you compare in archaeological context, you compare with the California, that they are called the baby rocks. These cuff marks stones are known as baby rocks in California, in the western part of America. And similarly in Moirbhanj also, there is a concept, if anybody is barren, the lady, and everybody not fulfill their wishes, they come to come and venerate these stones for fulfillment of their desires. And still the practice is going on in Ghantasila, which is very interesting. Another things and this is about the distribution of rock art sites. In Odisha, you can see the subject matters. 50% of the subject matters are, more than 50% subjects are on pictographs. Having subject matters are like your thematics and non-thematics. And 40% of the rock arts are in engravings. And 10% are both engravings and pigmented shelters you find in Odisha. And in the Mahanadi, broadly in the Mahanadi Valley, we find this phenomena from the upper Mahanadi Valley to the up to the coastal region. And the subject matters, as I have already discussed about the thematic and non-thematics, and the recent findings in the Chandaka also gives a new light to the rock art research in the Odisha. The Ghantasila of the Moirbhanj also gives a new dimension and for further study, which encourages the further study of rock art research in that area, which is very rich in this type of rock art heritage. And besides this, we have very strong belief and practices associated with rock art in Orissa. Professor Pradhan had did a lot of works about the ethnographical parallels of the rock art. You can see the rock shelters in Middle Mahanadi Valley in Sambalpur districts. It's basically we find engravings, and this is in Sundargarh districts, and this is in the coastal plain, very near to Bhubaneswar Chandaka. And you can see this is exclusively, we don't have any paintings in the Middle Mahanadi Valley regions. Most of the shelters, more than 40 shelters, have executed with engravings. Both scoopings and engraving, you can see the antelopes and similar type of engravings in that area in the Sambalpur districts. And the shelter is known as Deulga. Deulga means is venerated. Dio means god, and Ulga means bow down their head in front of this. This is a concept. And this is a kind of deer. And this shows the artistic talent of the prehistoric man. How is anatomical features is looking backwards. This is the development stage of the motifs, you can see. And these are geometric patterns, honeycombs. You can see honeycombs. There is maze patterns, rectangular patterns. You can see there is a giraffe found. And that before it was called giraffe, but later on is we can add is an ostrich. Because you can see the circular oval shapes are below. And within Sobal, there is this vulva, triangles, and the vulva was depicted. And this is very unique for the Middle Mahanadi Valley, this species, ostrich. If you can, this is ostrich like bat. It looks like ostrich having those egg. And it's very interesting. It is both it's pigmented engravings. You can see this is pigmented engravings in another shelters. And you can see the deer and vulva. You can see in the Sundargarh region, we have also some shelters in the Tongo. have engravings, for example, pigmented engravings. And here you can see the paws marks of animals, triangles, subhalva, and you can see there's a diamond patterns within triangles. You can see that the depiction of diamond patterns which is related to, you can say, the fertility cult. And here you find some broom patterns and in paintings in Sundar, in Jharsuguda districts, in Ulabgarh. Is in the same shelter, we find both in paintings and engravings in Sundargarh districts, the boar-like features and some geometric patterns above. And here also the engravings, and you can see another maize, depiction of maize in right side. And these are the palm engravings, and in scooping, you can see in scooping. And this is a painting in Sundargarh in Lekhamuda region, and this is another shelters Lekhamuda. There are more than 12 shelters Lekhamuda. 1, 2, 3 were just put the nomenclature for proper identification. And can see these are paintings, both frog, palms, and footmarks, and some oval patterns. You can see in the Lekhamuda, another Lekhamuda. You can see both paintings in can see in the dark ochre color, even in white. And one razor, geometric patterns, rectangular patterns. In Lekhamuda is a butterfly, palm motifs. As already most of the scholars know, the Odishan rock arts are most representation of non-thematic arts or symbolic representations. And this is another area in Bargarh districts in the very located to a reservoir, Mahanadi, Hirakud Dam reservoir. Here the formation is completely different. Here the land, the geological formation is of quartzitic formation, where in other part we see basically in sandstone formation. And this is Adhai Akhar, basically is a very late periods engravings. And these are the new discoveries in 2017 in Pandavabakhar and Katak district in the coastal Odisha. These are maybe very late. And interestingly that in these shelters, we found some motifs like harpoon patterns. And in 2017-18, we excavated sites nearby to the site, around 10-15 kilometers away from the sites. And in the same sites, we found in the ceramics, there is a the paintings executed on the ceramics have similar patterns. Similar motifs are depicted in the ceramics, and the ceramics are dated to the MS dates are 3,500 years BP. There's an interesting thing. This is Hathi Gumpha. Then in Odisha, very few thematic scenes like domestication of animal scenes. And this is another broom patterns, but I'm just saying that the crop mark patterns executed particularly, this is typical features. I have never seen such type of depiction in anywhere in India till that. I have already told many of my friends, if anybody has such type of depiction in Jharkhand or in other area, then it will be a good light. And because this is I said these are crop mark patterns, and this is very unique. And this shelter is very associated with Rama and Sita. And this is in Moyurbhanj. This is a hunting scene of deer. And this already I mentioned about a shelter in Chormada in the border region of Chhattisgarh. Exclusively here you can find cuff marks or cupules arid in the whole surface. There is no paintings or anything here. And this one I am telling in the Moyurbhanj in Ghantasila regions. And few boulders are like this executed with their cuff marks, known as Bhimoantu. जो घुटनों बोलते हैं, घुटनों में मार दिए भीम जैसे, और पीपल्स आर वेनरेटेड एंड गिव रेस्पेक्ट टू दिस बोल्डर्स, एंड दिस वेरी न्यू फेनोमेना कम आउट इन ओडिशन रॉक आर्ट. एंड अनदर फीचर्स, वेदर वी कॉल्ड इट्स रॉक आर्ट और नॉट, बट दिस इज इन द टेल वैली, इज अ ट्रिब्यूटरी ऑफ महानदी. वी फाउंड मेनी बोल्डर्स आर मैनिपुलेटेड इन टू फीमेल जेनिटल ऑर्गन्स और भल्वा in Sonpur district in the middle Mahanadi Valley. But basically this such type of art executed in the Tell Valley, and similar type of art also you can see in California. So in archaeological contents, this is very interesting. And about the antiquity of Odisha rock art. And this is the first excavation of rock art site by Professor Pradhan in 90s. And this is 90s is the peak period of rock art research in Odisha. And this shelters gives a cultural sequence from Mesolithic period to early historic periods. And these are the tools recovered by Professor Pradhan. This is microliths and some Neolithic tools and some iron tools. Objects are recovered from this excavation. And we have already do some ethno-archaeological interpretation of rock art. This is a Sora ethnic groups. And they have a very attachment with the art motifs. So we try to compare rock art with this ethnographical parlance. Anyhow, thank you.
Thank you. In fact, we have asked all the people to ask the questions and put in the chat box. We will be forwarding their questions to all the speakers. And they will have to respond through IGNC to them. So here there will be no time of question answer at this point of time. So we will be forwarding you people these questions. Now, thank you very much for this beautiful presentation. May I now call Dr. Devinder Viora to give his presentation on conservation of rock art, mainly on the eastern part of India. Maybe focus will be the eastern part of Odisha. Dr. Devinder Viora was our team member in the field also, is reader and head in the PG Department of Geology, Utkal University, Bhubaneswar. His key contributions in this field are integrated rock art management system and rock art risk index. To study the vulnerability of degrading rock arts and to suggest protecting measures, he has served as PAC member of rock art division of IGNC. He has authored a book on rock arts of Odisha, geology and conservation. Apart from that, he has authored 8 books and edited 5 books. He has published more than 175 papers and articles in different journals and periodicals. May I request Dr. Viora to start his presentation? May I please confine your presentation to 17 minutes, around 17-20 minutes.
Thank you, Mallaji. I would like to thank IGNCA and the team of rock art division for giving me opportunity to talk on the subject matter rock art conservation. This is indeed a very elaborative and also descriptive topic. But looking at the time constraint, I would like to manage the talk within the stipulated time, and for that I think we have to skip a lot of things because those will consume a lot of time. So at the present context, rock art is at risk. This means that rock arts are preserved or it is existing in the nature's museum under the threat of lot of natural degrading agents, and also we need these rock arts for our futuristic and also academic and research purposes, which draws our attention and also our course of action in preserving those things for futuristic use. So I would like to broadly talk on the risk factors. As you know, they are under the open sky, facing the sun, rain, wind, frost, and natural disasters. Those are the natural actions. Under the natural action, there are a lot of the threatenings, so which are coming under the climatic condition, topographic condition, geologic conditions, and also the terrain configurations. So along with that, a lot of man-made factors are there, like development projects, road constructions, house buildings, industries, mining and agriculture. These are the risk factors to the rock arts which are existing in the, basically in the forest regions, nearby the mining areas, and remote from the settlements. So the factors, the ruining story of the rock arts basically draws our attention for the future course of action in preserving those different purposes, for cultural, drawing the cultural, the social, the civilization entity of out of the rock arts. These are some of the ruining stories of the rock arts. You can see how the rock arts are getting invisible day by day out of the threatening agents or natural agents, and sometimes by the anthropogenic causes. So these are the rock arts. You can see here rock arts, they are fading away day by day due to a lot of factors. So we must give the reasons to those degradations, and these are the vandalisms. You can see here everywhere the vandalism, the anthropogenic causes, the tourism, etc. has a lot of effect on degrading the rock arts. Now, before going to the protection measures, let us talk on the damage development studies. How do you know that the rock art is in a condition of degradation? So we have to go for rock art studying the establishing the rock art risk index, which speaks the degree of loss or a hole or a part of rock art panel at risk resulting from natural or man-made phenomenon of a given magnitude. So whether it is in alarming condition, whether we are just explorer and it is a new phenomenon observed by us, that is most important to be noted down. So there are a lot of risk factors. We call the factors of risk indexes, which affect the rockers, just like the type of natural destructive agents, sun, rain, wind, frost, fog, snowfalls, the nature of destructive agents like scanty rainfall, heavy torrential cloudburst, continuity of action destructive agents like how it is occurring time to time or continuous or seasonal or throughout the year, whether the impact of the individual agents, whether it is only sun that is impacting upon the that means degradation of the rock arts, or whether it is rain or sun and rain or wind, then the impact of multiple destructive agents in combination of the sun, rain, wind, because these are broad factors. Then deposition of element at risk, then composition of element at risk, then architecture and dimension of the rock art, then anthropogenic reference, biogenic activities. So we can assess the damage by these following activities, and what might be the causes of the damage. You know what is the, why for we go for the protection. You should know first and assess the damages. Just you observe faking along the old cracks, maybe due to frost action, vegetation growth action, chemical vents, cavity formation in the rocks, breakage of the cavity, exfoliation basically due to temperature differences, frost action, treading up the rocks, then formation of cracks, fissures, joints on the panels, including micro cracks, then weakening of the rock surface due to erosion, withering and alteration, and overall and at last vandalism and other human induced damages like tagging, painting, sketching new figures, etc. So broadly we can divide the threats into physical, chemical and biological threats. For physical threats, the factors water, wind, carrying temperature, varying temperature, change in pressure, freezing and frost action. What is the result? Degradation, mechanical disintegration. Then the factors for the chemical threatening, that is carbon dioxide, oxygen, water, process of hydration and hydrolysis, and result is decomposition of varying chemical reactions. And biological threat also is very important, which is caused by animals, plants, microorganisms, burrowing animals, termites, bacteria, algal action, development of mosses and lichens. So that they result in biological withering of the rock arts. So basically the Eastern Indian rock arts faces a lot of physical withering due to its, the geographical situation, the geomorphology and the climatic condition. As because the rainfall is around 1500 millimeter and it is sufficient to make the hydration and also salt decay from the rocks. So by that, the cementing medium is removed from the rock arts and the rock particles or grains. That is why the rock arts are damaged. Insolation or solar radiation, breaking up the rock types through thermal expansion and contraction. The region is coming under arid and semi-arid conditions and hence experience significant diurnal temperature variation. Diurnal temperature variation causes lot of breakage, that is called also taking the moisture and insulation. So moisture within the rock increases the susceptibility to insulation fracture, quite effective in sandstone, but less effective in granite. Then these factors are responsible for the breakage depending upon the type of rocks, whether it is granite, is hard rock, sandstone or soft rock, or highly withered, degradable like limestone, etc. And at last the bushfires, normally naturally it occurs, or it is the people catch the fire in the jungle, which affect the more than 800 degrees Celsius temperature may affect the longevity or durability of the rock arts. The hydration cases, you can see in this photograph, the hydration is cementing materials. And actually it is capturing the rock arts and by the removing of these cementing materials from the rocks. Thermal expansion, which is one type of insulation, and here the insulation is clear. The insulation means it taking moisture, and due to the diurnal temperature difference, the flaking out of the materials from this site is getting triggered, and you can see the rockets are getting deteriorated time and again. So northern Odisha and the adjoining Jharkhand state, and also including Bihar, are tectonically active regions. So which changes in rock faces and rock structures and affect rocket sites in number of ways. Because of the deformative forces are more, the mining activities are occurring there, because these areas are full of natural resources, basically the mineral resources. The mining activities are done extensively. So the tectonic, that means the micro tectonic activities are triggered due to the blasting, what Professor Satchidananda Joshi was telling, stressing upon that. Because this area has a lot of natural resources and a lot of mining activities are going on, and day by day it is increasing with the blasting for removal of the rocks, that affect the seismic impact activity, affect the stability of the rock arts in this region. So you can see how the stability of the rocks are hampered due to those blasting or vibrations. Those are man-made also. And also due to natural tremors, lot of tremors, because where the minings are happening occur, lot of tremors occur monthly, daily, also some tremors do not feel. These are very much unstable, which are unstable in condition, they are affected by those tremors in particular these regions. And this is how the boulders, the inscriptions on the boulders, or you can call it as engravings, or petroglyphs, they are also damaged by the sandblasting, and also due to the vibrations and tectonic effect, and also some fluvial erosion. Then the structural elements includes the joints, fracture, cracks, and that impact the body by the deformation, and facilitate fragmentation, flaking, breaking, detachment of the rock masses. You see how detachment or dislodging of flakings from the rock arts, and it affects the rock arts in due course of time. You see lot of rock arts are removed from the site by the flaking or dislodging of the rock materials. You can see these are the jointed places, joints, natural geological joints. Due to deformation, these joints will be removed. That means the boulders will be removed from the joints or the in-situ bodies, thereby disturbing the rock arts. And you see the joints. Then what will be the positions you can assess? So that is the spatial disposition of the rocks at rock art panels. That means whether it is horizontal, vertical, gently slopy, or slightly slopy, because that matters in the stability of the rock art sites, basically, which are isolated rock arts on the boulders, and also in isolated alone, not in a big site or cave. So you can see these are isolated things which can be destroyed by its dispositions, because they are slanting, some are obliquely standing, some are horizontal. Those are the geoglyphs affected by seat jointings. So we can talk of fluvial damage. Many of the rock arts of the Odisha, Jharkhand, basically in Odisha, they are in the river banks or in the distributaries and tributaries of the Mahanadi, Baitarani, and other rivers of Odisha. They are prone to the fluvial erosion. They may be moved by the water, or sand moved by the water. Maybe the action is abrasive, and they are submerged annually under the high energy flood waters, and the kinetic energy of the water removes the or destroys the rock arts, that is the fluvial damage. Accordingly, the alluvial erosion are very prominent in the coastal regions. They are especially in the soft attacks, the soft rocks, calcinite and other soft sandstones in the limestones, and sandblasting is also occurs in the coastal regions. You see the fluvial regions, this is one stream, bed of the stream where some rock arts there in the bouldery formation of dolerites. And due to during the time of flood, they are inundated by the flood waters, and that kinetic energy hamper the stability of the. This is alluvial erosion which happens in the coastal area. This is in Khandagiri area, and the sandblasting. Sandblasting is removal of sands due to the external agents, blow of air, and also temperature difference and rain. Due to that, these palm structures. Engravings are in due course of time will be even. So then the chemical threat, which includes carbon dioxide, oxygen, water, and the alkalinity, acidity, pH value of the water, or carbonation or carbonic acid, sometimes sulfuric acid, because here sulfates are there and it is produced due to the mining and due to the acid mine drainage as well as the acid rains. They are affecting the region and also affecting the rock arts in this region. Then these are the chemical threat. You can see how the discoloration of the rock arts, and due to also bacterial actions also. Some are partly bacterial action or due to the chemical impact of this acidic and also the acidic water hydration. You see here, the incrustations are developed. These are the chemical solutions or the salt hydration or the salt solution. Then they are precipitated on the engravings. You can see the chemical threads. You can see how this coloration, this is in Sitabinj Keunjar. The colors have been faded, and also the colors have been transformed to different colors. These are hematitic colors. Later it is converting to different occurs like yellow, like purple. So this is also chemical impact. And you see the brooms, which were shown by Dr. Garnaik. And now the brooms is under threat. These are basically chemical and biological threats. Then most important thing is that biological threat, biological withering caused by the living beings, such as animal plants, friction damage by robbing the earth surface by movement of trees, interaction of animals, decay and disintegration of the rock arts by burrowing animals, termites, bacteria, algal action, development of mosses, lichens, dead animals, plants, and bird droppings. Then the human causes, invasion of human beings to the rock art sites. Some of the bacterial action, in just like they utilize the atmospheric nitrogen, converting it to ammonia and oxidizing those two, nitrous and nitric oxides. Similarly, oxide sulfur oxidized to sulfur, or sulfur to sulfur dioxide, which also is corrosive in nature. Then bacteria oxide iron and manganese from the minerals, that creates iron oxide and hydroxide. That causes lot of damage and also discoloration of the rock arts. Then the activities of fungi. Basically two fungi, Thallophyta and Saprotrophs, they are very active in destroying the rock arts. They produce oxalic and citric acid and can attack the various minerals. The saprotrophs occur commonly in the limestone caves and other locations who have the high humidity are there. So the blue igneous Cyanophyta, this is also they attack the rock surface, and the terrestrial green blue alga Chlorophyta also they attack the rock arts. Similarly, the lichens and mosses, they are active in destroying the rock arts. So these are the biological threats. You see the roots, how roots are penetrating, and termites, lot of termites are there. You see the termites, they are also encroaching the rock arts. Then these are the mosses and lichens, and also some blue-green algas are there. They have symbiotic relationship, and after encroaching that, the rock arts are destroyed. Then human threats, you can see the human threats. All of vandalisms. Then how do you protect the rock arts. That is that includes the image documentation, the condition assessment, then development of management plan and conservation actions. So through these management plan conservation actions, you can go to the deterioration protection measures, the diagram of deterioration. Here you have already discussed these are the affecting factors, and now what to do is you have to create three boundaries basically. The regulations, first you put the regulations which can restrict, then pollutants, remove the pollutants, degrading agents, then prohibition, then the enclosures, you can create the enclosures. Then the integrated rock art management system, it is very well given that the physical protection, how can you protect the geomorphological erosion weathering, how can you run up diversion, cementing, grouting, with the you can conserve the things. Then you can go for the compositional, you can joint fracture filling, land stabilization, faulted portion, grouting, and the ecological man-made, it can be prohibited by education, awareness, removal of vegetation, anti-termite organic treatments, fencing nearby the mining industry, So only the thing is that earthquake and the volcanoes, they cannot be tackled. Okay, this is the ERAMS, and these are the structural measures. You can protect the rock arts from rains, winds, and also sun. These are the structural measures. What are the dispositions and how can you erect the vertical geometry of panels with art of a slopy nature, impact from sun, you can protect from sun rain, and this is how can please you conclude. Give the shelter to the rock arts, and thank you.
Well thought out document, thank you very much. May I now request Dr. Sachin Tiwari, who will be talking on ethno rock art study of Bihar Kaimur range. Dr. Sachin Tiwari is working as assistant professor in Department of Ancient Indian History, Culture and Archaeology, BHU. Before that, he was serving in Archaeological Survey of India, Ministry of Culture, Government of India in different capacities on various places in India. He has worked in Ladakh for the documentation of rock art under MAPFIL Indo-French project, as well as he has explored and documented the rock art right from extreme north Ladakh to south tip of Kerala. May I request Dr. Sachin Tiwari to start his presentation? Please confine within your time. Thank you.
I'm very much thankful to the Yadadri Department of IGNCA for giving me an opportunity to present my small work. My deep gratitude to Professor Malla sir and all the respected listeners and the team behind this significant step in this pandemic. Actually, sir, just a few days ago, I have seen a documentary film made by you centered on the rock art of Jharkhand, and that documentary has also inspired me lots to work further. Now, I will start my talk, though, which is very vast and need much more time to explain an idea about all the work. But in the given time, I would try my best to present the work in brief. So this presentation has total 14 slides. So let me start with the problem in the rock art studies. As since 2007, it has involved me in this field and encountered many enigmas. The principal enigma of rock art is dating and the purpose of execution so far in my knowledge. I think this presentation may be a small step to think about the discussed purpose behind the execution of rock art. And I have focused a few communities like Kharwar, Orao, Musahar, and Bhar tribe of this region. In my second slide, as mentioned in the title, it is all about the ethno rock art study. It is important to explain the term ethno rock art. Basically, ethno rock art tries to interpret and understand rock art by establishing its linkage with the ethnic group, folklore, myths, beliefs, customs, rituals, and their cultural practices. So it is all about the ethno rock art. You can see in this slide that there has two picture in which this one, the right one picture, this one is from the Kharwar house, and this one, left one, is from the Kharwar house. Decorated the whole wall during the Karma festival, And the Musahar, this is the relief art made of mud over the Vatalinga wall. They made this during the worship of their tribal deities called Dina Bhadri. And sometime their another deity, Huinya Baba. And he usually rides on an elephant. So while doing this relief art work, an artist woman sung the lore of Dina Bhadri. So there is also a lore while doing this artwork. So two important things I want to discuss here. Number one, if you know the meaning of any symbol or scene, this is my personal experience since 2007, what I have faced. So any symbol or scene, then it is not necessary that we get the same meaning in all contexts. According to the context and tradition of that particular place, the style of rock art depiction will also change. For example, the symbol of hand cannot be the symbol of Ratri festival alone, or a pregnant woman or a child born in that particular house. There, that is why they put palm. At some place, it is a symbol to indicate its presence, or even totem, or a kind of ka. Similarly, in the context of plus in circle, for some it is the symbol of date of birth, and for some it is the sacrament is based on references. It is basically the contextual study of the symbol, signs, and narrations. Number two, if you are trying to find answers to the questions around the rock art sites that can explain the continuity and purpose of rock art, then it is our big mistake. Because political and social issues of Indian states have not been like the Bushman tribe of Africa and Dreamtime rock art of Australia. We, like them, can know the continuity of rock art in its place, its purpose, provided that we know who were the original inhabitants of the place. Whereas they now and under what circumstances was their creation? If we are able to find the answer to these questions, then we will definitely know the importance, purpose, and makers of this art. But it is also very difficult to find an undisputed life. In this country where the meaning and security has continued the process of migration even today, the answer to any direct question will not be found directly. We must also study the dying folklore, myths, legends, beliefs. We can get answers to almost all our questions, but questions should be asked from the right person or from the right community. The search for the right person is the answer of those questions, and they continue to take these traditions with them even today with some changes. In this study, we also required to study the psychogenetics behavior, and that is very important. In my next slide, today, those dimensions should be seen on the basis of which we are revealed the purpose of rock art. For this purpose, I have made components called structure of ethno-rock art. This is not a discovery, but it is a perfect inclusion of all the scattered dimensions. I believe that today, the secret of rock art are hidden in folklore, folk dance, ritual practices, witchcraft, totem, marriage, funeral rites, etc. I believe that today, work may have been done on these aspects as well, the work is further expected. In this structure, you can see that 9 so different dimensions. These dimensions are in continuation of rock art and the study of whose purposes and discussions will lead us to our object. So the number one is the nomenclature. It is nomenclature, and as you can see, the nomenclature. There are many places and shelters which are still known as some of the peculiar name, like Makari Kho. Here in Bhagwanpur, Kamur region, there is a shelter Makari Kho. Why they are calling it Makari Kho? Because the paintings over the wall of the cave is like, look like it means a spider, Makari Kho. And Kho is the cave. Another example, Lekhuniya Dari, that is in UP. And Lekhuniya is because the lake means draw something, retain something, and Dari is the word for the cave, and Dari word is very well illustrated in the Kalidas literatures. Number two, there are some mythology about the shelter and depictions among the local that is also quite important to document. Number three, folklore of the native tribes are enormous record of the regional history. Deep study of the folklore is also helpful to describe the rock art. Number four, there are many ancient literatures describing about the caves and chitra or dari right from the Rigveda to medieval period. This is also great source to say that there is clear cut evidence of the legacy of painting practices. Number five, the wall painting, which is very common and everywhere it is visible on various occasions, festivals, rituals, customs. Number six, there are many examples of movable objects like a kothila, kothi, and with the artistic work even today among the local communities. Number seven, there is need to study the rock art and tattoo practices art in a certain age on a decided date. That is very important to study the tattoos. Number eight, there are still many living practices like dance, hunting, like rat hunting, the Musahar, they are still practicing and the same paintings we are getting from the rock art sites. So these are great evidence of continuity. And number nine, you must have seen some of the signs and symbols which are very commonly used in the entire world, like swastik. That is very common in Africa, Europe, India, everywhere. So it is psychogenetics deals. It is with the effect of genetic inheritance on mental processes or behavior since long time, and it will also remain in our gene for long. In my next slide, this is just an example to say that this is not new that we started to know about the ethno rock art or to study the ethno archaeological part of rock art. It was also already started by John Emmons Cockburn, but it is our fault that we never carried for long. So this is the next slide. This is my location map of Bihar, where you can see the Kamur range and northeastern part of Chhotanagpur, and these are the locations where we have the rock art sites. With this slide, I would like to show you the practice of applying tikka over the rock surface near to the rock art sites. Local community call it Bhuiya Mai. And when I asked that why you are calling it Bhuiya Mai, they said once Mai, means the mother, was in the shelter, which is about 100 meters above this particular stone, about 100 meters, just 100 meters. There is a painter dog shelter, and that is stone fallen down from that top of the hill. And according to her, that our ancestors were worshipping this goddess since long. But now, because it is here, we call it Bhuiya. Bhuiya, the word etymology is Bhu, Dhara. And now the mother is over the Dhara. That is why they are calling it Bhuiya Mai. This is also a great evidence of continuity of means ritual practices. This is Kariya Marad. Actually, we have one folklore in Kambur region, and the folklore is about the battle between Oram and Kharwar, and they have described about the war between Oram and Kharwar and how elephants and horses helped them. In the folklore, they have called Kariya Marad, ke Kariya Laurva. This is Kuduk language, and you can see these two human figures. According to them, these are the Baram Baba of local deities, and sometimes they used to call it Kariya Marad, and there is a long stick between their leg. And this is the best example of Karma festival and how they are performing it. You can see the Karma tree over here, and just near to this tree, there is a circle of human. They holding hands and dancing, and the same things still continue. Next, please. Sir, this is the best example of ethno rock art practices. Palm print basically. It is their belief that if they will do the same, because of this that their grains will save and the invisible power, they will not affect this means property. Next, please. Tattoo art. It is very interesting. That is why I have showing this particular slide. You can see here the tattoo of a woman, and according to her, this is the house of a god, and covered with a dense forest. And the similar art we have in the rock art of Jammui and this is the right one, D. D one is the from the Kamur region of Bihar, and that one is from the Jamui, which is provided by Subham Sharad. And that another Devakula painting. So how tattoo art is very much means associated or related with the rock art, and the similar practice is still coming, is still in our society during the marriage. Next piece. This is the practice showing the primitive means work of our pastime. Everything is very clear, the dance scene, the bow and arrow, and the Bagh Bakriya game playing by the Kharwara tribe. Next, please. Okay, this is my last slide. And this is the great evidence of showing the relation between this symbol. We usually call it labyrinth. And this is from the Bhar tribal house, and they are not permanent residents of this region, as she said. She draws it because her mother-in-law guided her to do it after the birth of a baby. When I asked the purpose, she said that child will grow like this plant with lots of fruits and flowers. This is very common symbol found in every part of the world. And here in Bihar, this circle is for the totemic activities, like Najar Nalage or Najar Battu kind of things. So with this slide, sir, I just want to say to my all listener that this was just my introductory part of means work. Each and every structural point need the time and discuss in detail with logic and tangible evidences. So many things I have to discuss to say that we have similar evidence like Australia and Africa to say that the continuity of rock art, just we need to record it. Thank you very much to my all listener and respected teachers. Thank you.
Thank you very much for giving a different aspect of interpretation of rock art, which is widely accepted. Maybe we will have not direct answers to the rock art, but we will be having indirect definitely. So now the next presentation will be by Dr. Om Prakash Kumar. He will be talking on rock art of Vindhya Kaimur Hills, a cultural and ethno-archaeological study. Dr. Om Prakash Kumar is serving as an assistant professor in Department of Ancient Indian History and Archaeology at DAV PG College, BHU, Varanasi. He is pursuing his postdoctorate as ICHR fellow. He has worked on UGC-funded research project, Indian Culture and Heritage Studies, University Potential Excellence Scheme as research assistant, and excavated different sites as French supervisor. He has published 9 research papers and 2 chapters in edited volumes. He discovered some rock art sites in Chandoli district, Uttar Pradesh, and Kharoli and Ratnapura in Kaimur district, Bihar. May I request Dr. Om Prakash to start his presentation and complete within 15 to 20 minutes.
Thank you to IGNC for the providing me this opportunity. I want to present my lecture, Rock Art of Vindhya Kaimur Hills, a cultural and ethno-archaeological study. Cultural background, a rocky country which rises gradually from the south of Ganges Deep Plain, culminate in the highland of central India, Indore, Bhopal, Bundelkhand, etc. The southern edge of this country is a steep line of prominent escarpment which constitute the Vindhyan Mountain. The Vindhyan Plateau mainly occupy part of the Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, and Bihar is divided into 2 parts. The first known as Kaimur Range as the crow fly. The river Son is the southern boundary of it. Mirzapur, Sonbhadra, Chandauli district of Uttar Pradesh, Rohtas, Bhabua, Kaimur district of Bihar comes under the Kaimur Range. Kaimur Range is full of rock shelters. In these rock shelters, the stone as man was the attracted for the protecting himself from the sunlight, heavy rain, and wild animal, and created in rock art. Early rock art research in the Kaimur is in the Kaimur Range, Mirzapur, now at Sonbhadra, is the well-known district in Indian rock art research. A.C.L. Carlyle made the first discovery of the rock art site in the forest region near the Aurora between 1867-68. John Cockburn published a note on the cave painting of the Kaimur Range, mentioned that this drawing has also been noticed by A.C.L. Carlyle. 240 painted rock shelters have been reported by the J. Gupta in the district. But exact location and number of these rock shelters is not known in the exploration that done by Rakesh Tiwari. In the Kaimur Range, Allahabad University and the Banaras Hindu University have done the extensive exploration time to time. The Kaimurian rock art explorations in the Bihar state were fruitful by the R.C. Agrawal and R.G. Pandey by the more many scholars. Understanding the chronological order of the rock art of Indian Kaimur Hills. Chronological setup of rock art is fruitful study. Some rock shelter surface has been painted several times by the successive primitive artists who occupied these shelter at different times. Sometimes, because of the extensive painting, the rock surface becomes so heavily colored that it becomes difficult to identify the painting and their details. Apart from the several method of dating, which is spectrographic photography, infrared photography, analysis of color, which has been published here, for the want to require scientific mechanism and laboratories in India. Recent attempt to find chronological indicator of rock art from the associated artifact, though the excavations have helped to some extent in the establishing the antiquity of some of these paintings. Stylistically, the drawing may be classified in Upper Paleolithic period, Mesolithic period, Neolithic, Chalcolithic period, and historical period also. Rock art of Vindhya Kaimur Hills may be classified on the basis of Indian rock art in brief as rock art of hunter-gatherer society, Paleolithic, Mesolithic period, rock art of pastoralist and agriculturalist society, Neolithic, Chalcolithic, and metal-using society normally, rock art of early historic society, emergence of Kharosthi and Brahmi script. Introduction. The Kaimur Hills of the bordering Uttar Pradesh, Bihar are the home of the several important rock shelters which are presenting to historical period. Exploration have conducted in the region right from the British period. The result of exploration have been published from time to time. In my exploration of southern eastern Uttar Pradesh and Rajasthan part of Bihar, I came across several painted rock shelters in the Kaimur Hills. These painted rock shelters are the Chakya, Tala, Dhoranpur, Kaurihar Khas, Sultanpur, Baba Kilain, Ghuraupur in Chandauli district, Uttar Pradesh, and the Kharauli Ratanpurwa in Kaimur district, Bihar. The present paper proposed to highlight the depiction appertaining the cultural and ethno-archaeological state. Ethnic society in the Kaimur Hills near Latipsa. Latipsa Dam has been constructed during the British time period. Here River Karnasa is entered in the plain region. Latipsa area is the adjacent part of the plateau, the Gangetic Plain. The dam is perennial, so that is the area appropriate for the flora and the fauna that is flourish in this area. Exploring in rock art of Indian Kaimur Hills, India is the country of diversity and culture is its virtue. The change visible in the country, just like every state seem a country, but unity is diversity in India character. Indian culture based on religion, food habit, dance, music, art, architecture, language, and traditions. Religious fact. In France and Spain, southwestern Europe, Lasso and Altamira Cave are the situated. These are the full of hunting and animal depiction. One interpretation is that if Stone Age man depicted a bowsing in cave, and if he go out for the game, in this situation he may be success. Bindhi Kaimur Hills rock shelters have different types of hunting scene. If it is accept that the interpretation of European rock art apply on Kaimurian rock art, that is why this painting depicted for the some purpose. So it is matter to religion. Gurupur rock shelters, district Chandauli, UP, is of the great archaeological importance because the rock shelters held archaeological material like potsherd, stone tools, Buddha depiction, deer sanctuary, and lake depiction of Sarnath scenario present Buddhist religion. In this shelter, many of the paintings available from the Neolithic time period to Gupta period. Here is a presentation. In the same rock shelters, Buddha depiction in Vitarka style, Ghatsepa stupa is also available. The same type image has been found on Sanchi stupa. Radhapurva rock shelters, Kaimur Bhagwa, Bihar, has a sand depiction in the yoga posture. It is the representation of the Hindu religion, but here is not site available, so I'm not presenting here. In Chalcolithic rock shelters, Chandauli, UP, Chakya rock shelters, Chandauli, UP, depicted dancing scene in the pleasure of the hunting. A stick type human figures are dancing with the weapons, and also available group dancer at Tala rock shelters, Chandauli, and many other sites. Music. Music is the voice of life that birth by instrument, vocal at that time, feel that glad of every organ of body. Music has two stem, instrument and vocal. A singing scene is discovered at the Tenui rock shelters. In this painting, no any movement visible in the leg, but hand posture present in a singing styles. Ethno-archaeological study. In the left side, a enclosure discovered from the Kaimur Bhagwa at the site of Ratanpurva, and right side, primitive technology of modern animal enclosure, Dhoranpur Chandauli. In the modern scenario, it is a cattle pen where the many animals husbanded in the modern time period. It is an aspect of ethno-archaeological evidence. And other animal husbandry evidence of pregnant cattle showing the domestication at Gurupur rock shelters in Chandauli district. And other painting of the cow present domestication of the animal and living the painting of tradition from prehistoric time period. It is a painting available on a Kharwar family on his mud wall. Thank you for providing the opportunity to present my lecture.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar, to be precise, and it was a very informative lecture. Thank you very much. May I invite now Dr. Colonel A.K. Prasad, today's last presentation of the evening. He will be talking on rock art of Eastern India with special reference to Southern Bihar and Jharkhand. Some unique and special features. Dr. Colonel A.K. Prasad is well known for his discoveries of 97 rock art sites and ancient rock inscriptions, 18 prehistoric sites, 4 megalithic sites, and important Buddhist cave monasteries from Nauda, Jumai, Nalanda and Gaya districts in Bihar and adjoining Girida and Kodama districts of Jharkhand. Besides being the author of pioneering book The Bills of Khandesh and the Eastern and the British East India Company 1818 to 1857, Dr. Prasad has contributed new research articles related to prehistoric rock art, Stone Age industries, Buddhism, and ancient rock art inscriptions in various national and international journals. I can understand that he is a knowledge house and he has a great knowledge of different rock art forms of both Bihar and Jharkhand. He has extensive work here, and we will like to include all his research and all his experience in the publication. May I request him to start his presentation and be within time, please.
At the outset, I express my grateful thanks to Professor Satyadanand Joshi, the Member Secretary, and Professor B.L. Malla, the Head Adidishya IGNCA, for inviting me to present a paper in this very important webinar. Topic of my presentation is Rock Art of Eastern India, with a special reference to Southern Bihar and Jharkhand, some unique and special features. Rock art sites in Eastern India comprising the states of Bihar, Jharkhand, Odisha, and West Bengal are located in Chotanagpur Plateau, the northeastern projection of the Indian Peninsula. Rock art mainly comprising pictogram, that is the rock paintings, in this vast forested hilly region is generally located in very remote, difficult, and dangerous areas. Endowed with rich natural resources, these rock art regions are mostly inhabited by various tribal communities. The rich Eastern Indian rock art, while sharing many common features with other Indian rock art regions, also contains some very unique and special traits, as well as some very important features. In this presentation, it would be my endeavor to present a brief account of these distinctive traits and some other important special features observed in the rock art of Southern Bihar and Jharkhand in particular, and Eastern India in general. Since rock art of Odisha and Kaimur range located in the southwestern Bihar is already covered by previous scholars, I would be dealing mainly with the rock art of Southern Bihar and Jharkhand. Distribution of rock art sites in Eastern India is about 250. District-wise distribution of rock art sites in each state is as shown in this slide. Bihar, 143, Jharkhand, 51, Odisha, 55, but I'm happy that now the number has gone to 120 as per the information provided by the previous speaker, Dr. Gannaak. In the present state of Bihar, rock art was discovered for the first time on 1994 by me in Rani Gadar Forest in Kaugapur block of Nawada district in Bihar. Subsequently, about 100 rock shelters, open rock surfaces containing rock art, were also discovered by me in other adjoining districts of Jamui, Nalanda and Gaya, as well as Giridih and Kodarma. The last two districts now form part of Jharkhand. And distribution, you know, is already covered. And just to add, in West Bengal, there is only one rock art site, that is in Purnia. Location map, you see rock art sites are found in Bihar, mostly in the southern part and southwestern part. Jharkhand, mostly in northern Jharkhand, as well as central portion. And of course, as already illustrated earlier, in Odisha, in the mostly these are found in the western part of Odisha. Now, distinctive traits in the rock art of Eastern India, especially Southern Bihar and adjoining Jharkhand. In-depth study of the rock art of Eastern India, particularly Southern Bihar and adjoining Jharkhand, reveals prevalence of distinctive thematic, motivational, and stylistic traits in the rock art of this region. It differs from other Indian rock art regions, especially that of Central India. The special features indicating existence of distinctive thematic, motivational, and stylistic traits in the rock art of Eastern India are followed. Predominance of symbols and geometric signs, intricate designs, selection of only one rock shelter out of the cluster of many shelters for producing rock art. Next one, predominance of ritualistic scenes, and lastly, frequent depictions of shamans and anthropomorphs. A unique feature of Eastern Indian rock art, and especially the rock art of Southern Bihar and Jharkhand, is the obvious predominance of symbols, intricate designs, and geometric signs right from the Upper Paleolithic period down to the early historic era. Each and every painted rock shelter in Southern Bihar and adjoining Jharkhand invariably contains several symbols and geometric signs. In other parts of Jharkhand also, to quote Irvin Neumeier, the most eye-striking features of paintings are overwhelmingly geometric patterns with intricate designs of many variations. In Odisha too, the subject matter is by and large non-figurative and non-thematic, as also mentioned by the earlier speaker. To quote Sadashiv Pradhan, what is seen in the host of intricate and enigmatic, geometric and non-geometric patterns made of a host of spiral lines, cross hatches and zigzag lines. Nowhere, if you have time, then we can. In this aspect, the rock art of India differs from the cave art of Europe, which is mainly geomorphic, and the rock art of Spanish Levant, South Africa and Central India, which have an almost equal percentage of human and animal figures. Eastern Indian rock art also differs from the rock art of Chambal Valley, where animals are most frequent subject matter, and that of Mirzapur and Kumayu Himalayas, where human figures constitute the main body of the painted motifs. Nowhere in India, and perhaps in the whole world, such predominance of symbols, geometric signs, intricate designs, indicating the ritualistic and shamanistic nature of rock art is so clearly noticed. Now let's have some visual illustrations. The famous rock shelter ISKCO in Hazaribagh district, its entire wall and ceiling is covered with symbols, intricate designs and geometric signs. Closer view of the geometric patterns. Next, another example from rock shelter 11B, Janamthan Hills, Jamui, Bihar. Here also you find entire wall of the rock shelter is covered with geometric patterns all over and symbols. Of course, Orissa has already been covered. Just one example from there, rock shelter Lekhamoda 2. Here also we find all over on the wall geometric patterns depicted. Now next is selection of only one rock shelter or cave out of the entire cluster of producing paintings and engravings. Only one rock shelter out of entire cluster of numerous rock shelters was selected for producing paintings and engravings. This special painted rock shelter or cave was most probably considered a sacred space, a sort of temple or a community center for performing ritualistic, ceremonial and other important group activities. This trend is also observed in the neighboring state of Odisha, where the painted rock shelter, locally known Lekhamoda, is also called Ushakuthi, meaning worship or ritual chamber, or Ushakupa, meaning ritual cavity. Here we find a complex of about 27 rock shelters all over. Rock shelters are here, but painting is found only in one of them. It's here. Next, predominance of ritualistic scene. In the rock art of Southern Bihar and Waring Jharkhand, there is frequent depiction of ritualistic scenes pertaining to hunting, dancing, religious and magical rites. Here, even the hunting scenes are primarily symbolic and ritualistic, in which the archers are generally not shown engaged in actual hunting. Here, a hunter is just holding his bow and arrow against animal. Here, even dance scene is quite static. Another example, a shaman is shown standing on a bird-like creature holding a bow and arrow in his right hand. Now, next is frequent depiction of shamans and anthropomorphs. Surrounded by various types of geometric signs, they are generally shown with some animal bird-like heads spread out, unusual legs, and with very big phalluses, like the rock art of Sand tribe of South Africa. Rock art of Eastern India also reflects overwhelming role of shamans. The male shaman, locally called Bhagat, and the female as Bhaktini still play very important role in performance of religious, social, ceremonial rituals in the tribal communities in Bihar and Jharkhand, as well as in Odisha. Some illustrations, see here, a shaman with bird-like head, surrounded by all over by geometric patterns. Another example, old and new wooden slippers and spiked planks used by the Bhagat during the previous ceremonies, religious ceremonies, that is from Rock Shelter 3A1 in Rani Gadar Forest, Kogakol block of Nawada district. Here, a Bhaktini performing ritual for improving health of a sick child in village Giridi district, Jharkhand. Now, besides the above mentioned unique traits pertaining to the subject matter, motivation and style, the rock art of Southern Bihar and Jharkhand also contains some other special features. These are as following. Rock painting in very rare blue color, engraved figure of hound bulls and humpless cattle on a granite hillock, unique Buddhist Dharma Chakra and other rare Buddhist antiquities, painted figure of Garuda Dhwaja in a rock shelter, a large number of extremely important Kharoshthi Brahmi and Shak inscriptions. Now, a very rare painting in blue color that was found on the wall of rock shelter 25A2 in Sarkanda Hills in Gobindpur block of Nawada district in Bihar on the Bihar-Jharkhand border. It depicts heart-like structure. This is the only example of rock painting in blue color so far reported in India and amongst only a few known in the world. Engraved figure of hound bulls and humpless cattle on granite boulder in Rajabhat forest in Gawam block of Kodarma district. You find here hump bulls in triangle and here right side humpless cattle with concave horns. These engraved hump bull figures have much resemblance with the engraved humped bulls reported by Professor Sundara in the far off rock art region of Karnataka in South India. These engraved humped bull figures with their unique style and feature remind the Harappan bulls. Now next is painted figure of a Garuda Dhwaj in shelter 3A2, Rani Gadar Forest, Kogakol block, district Nawada. Garuda Dhwaj, painted figure. And here, right side, there are fragmented Kharoshthi inscriptions. It points to the cult of Bhagavata and to one of its Kharoshthi using what it is. It's quite important. We have in Vidisha, of course, it, you know, a Garuda Dhwaj. But here we find it is in painting form. Extremely important ancient rock inscriptions. As far as ancient rock inscriptions are concerned, Bihar and adjoining Jharkhand rock art region is extremely important and most probably the richest one in India. A large number of Kharoshthi, Kharoshthi Brahmi and Shankh rock inscriptions datable to circa 1st century BC to 10th, 11th century AD are found in several rock shelters and open rock surfaces, mostly located in Nawada, Jamui, Giridi and Kodarma district. These inscriptions have important bearings on history of India. I am much grateful to Professor B.N. Mukherjee for deciphering these inscriptions. Here, I see, earlier it was this information was available in the literature that when the traders or travelers from northwestern section of Indian continent used to go to Tamralipti while passing through Magadha region, they used to develop some faith in the local rituals of Magadha, and occasionally they used to perform it also. But there was no proof. For the first time, we have found a proof. Now, here, there is a magical diagram, and above and along this circle, we have Kharosthi inscription, Naha Saga Amineshana Madhatre. It means, my name is Naha, I belong to Saka clan, I am performing this ritual to harm my opponent Aminashana. It is the earliest datable epigraphic evidence in India about performing a local practice by a Kharosthi using Saka traveler in circa 2nd century AD. Another example, a Kharosthi Brahmi inscription deciphered as Shri Vrata. See, here we find a human figure holding a wheel, and above this wheel, this inscription is painted. It is the earliest datable epigraphic compictorial evidence of performing a ritual for getting the favor of God's wealth. Another one is a Brahmi inscription, which is deciphered as Pula Thangra. Here we find a man in Scythian dress, and near him is a wheel, and both sides there are two sections of Brahmi inscriptions, which can be read as Kula Thangra. It can be translated as the wheel of Vishnu, which is the foremost one in the front. Apparently, the man in Scythian dress was a worshipper of Vishnu or Krishna, and his wheel Sudarshan Chakra. Datable to circa 4th century AD, the inscription reveals the affiliation of a man of non-indigenous origin to Vaishnava cult sect. The famous Doospani rock inscription in 13 lines, it was discovered by Sir A. Cunningham, and it was rediscovered by me on 27th April 1997. Now, prominent place of Buddhism in rock art of this region. It appears that some of the cave containing rock painting converted into Buddhist cave monastery during the early historic period. About a dozen of monasteries discovered by me during the 1990s and 210 contain very important aspects related to Buddhism. Now, here is a cave with a very important Buddhist cave chakra. Depiction of a Buddhist wheel or law, that is Dharma Chakra, is quite common in Buddhism, but it is not depicted independently. It is always found in association with some other image object related to Buddhism, such as pair of tear and footprints, etc. For the first time in history of Buddhism, a Buddhist Dharma Chakra has been found independently engraved on the floor of a cave monastery in Rajgir Hills. It was discovered by me on 17 February 2010. This is the engraved Dharma Chakra engraved on the floor of that cave. Another extremely important painted Buddhist cave monastery, 6A1, remains of fresco made over the earliest rock painting on the wall. Decorated ceiling, then Dharma Chakras on the wall, and other paintings. Now here, a very rare Kharosthi Brahmi monogram. It can be deciphered as Layasya, that is name of a person. Now, some clay tablets depicting Buddha in various postures, and the Bija Mantra or the creed is inscribed here in Brahmi. Now, here we find it is a terracotta seal containing Kharosthi Brahmi inscription deciphered as Buddha Saga, that is great sacrifice, datable to circa 2nd century AD. And here we find clay seals bearing Brahmi inscriptions. The rock art of Eastern India in general and Southern Bihar and Jharkhand in particular contains distinctive thematic, motivational and stylistic traits quite different from other Indian rock art regions, especially Central India. Here, unlike other rock art regions, subject matter mainly consists of symbols, geometric signs and ritualistic scenes right from the Upper Paleolithic period to early historic era. Nature of the subject matter indicates that motivation of producing rock art here was primarily ritualistic or shamanistic. The rock art of Southern Bihar and Jharkhand also contains some special features, such as selection of only one rock shelter out of the entire cluster of several rock shelters for executing paintings, paintings of blue color, engraved figure of hound bulls, as well as humpless cattle, independently engraved Buddhist Dharma Chakra, painted figure of Garuda Dhwaja, and extremely important ancient rock inscriptions in Kharoshthi, Kharoshthi Brahmi, Brahmi, and Shank. With these distinctive traits and special features, the rock art of Eastern India occupies a very important and special place on the map of Indian rock art. Immediate remedial measures must be undertaken for conservation and preservation of this irreplaceable and most valuable cultural treasure. We must remember that a Taj Mahal can be rebuilt, but not a painted rock shelter like the Ambedkar or ISKCON. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Prasad, for a very descriptive and detailed talk. I know you have a lot to say. Maybe we will be covering it all in the proceedings of the webinar. For the proceedings of the webinar, may I request all of you to submit your papers within 15 to 20 days so that we can bring proceedings at the earliest. And I will also like to suggest to you people to come with some recommendations for the rock art of Eastern India, maybe a blueprint of type of thing, what we can do in the eastern part of India from the documentation, research, excavation, interpretation, and conservation point of view, so that in future we can plan our projects accordingly. So I must say that for rock art of Eastern India, so far I have not been able to have a good interdisciplinary team. We have two or three youngsters in this panel. May I request them to come out with a interdisciplinary team so that we can start our research and documentation from a holistic perspective in that area also. So far we have a great works like Dr. Prasad's and otherwise, but I would like to have it documented in an interdisciplinary format also. Because in IGNC, what we are doing the interdisciplinary documentation in a prescribed format developed throughout for the database of rock art of India. So I would like to have in our database the rock art of Eastern India, although we have from the Odisha and Jharkhand, Odisha, yes, detailed Professor Pradhan has done. Maybe in the meantime, something new has come. I will request Dr. Gannaike to see into it and how we will do that. And for the Om Prakash and Dr. Sachin, I will also like to request them to see from the Bihar and Jharkhand point of view. Dr. Prasad is always their mentor for that also with us. So we can do the things in a holistic perspective and make the rock art of Eastern India on the global format very familiar, which a credit it deserves is not getting at present. We should do for that, work for that. So I request you all for that. So for the academic session today, we have five presentations which range from the documentation, interpretation and conservation point of view. So these were well presented documentations, and for the documentation of Orissa, yes, there is a lot of scope for the interdisciplinary documentation because we have all the three aspects. Whatever is necessary for the documentation of the interpretation of rock art, because so far what we have been doing is mostly the documentation part, and interpretation is a linear thing, not an interdisciplinary thing. So for that purpose, yes, we should try to do interdisciplinary documentation in all parts of India. Wherever we have done and wherever we have not done, we may add to that where we have done. So for the ethnoarchaeological studies, ethnographical studies, we have the two presentations. I must say here, whenever we interpret the rock art from the present to the past, it is the only source for the interpretation of rock art. We have three sources. That is ethnoarchaeological study, archaeological study, or psychoanalytical study. We should feel proud enough that we have continuity of tradition, is it? And we have the ethnographical sources and archaeological sources in the context still to make it a very scientific subject. We have tried to do that, and we should do that in future also. And for the conservation point of view, we have been trying to develop a conservation manual. For that, we are trying to, what I was talking of, the uniform format for the rock art. What we have been doing, we have been documenting that in a uniform format of all the rock art sites, where the conservation and the geological formation of the rocks and other things is very important aspect. The objective is only to bring out a conservation manual for that. And for that, I must congratulate also Dr. Bevora, who is doing seriously work in this field. He is associated with us from about 2 decades in this rock art field. So we hope his services will be taken in future also. So these are the things which I wanted to share with you. And in future, we should do many things. You can recommend what we can do good for, which will be good for the rock art research and documentation of India, so that we can plan our projects accordingly in future also. So again, I would like to request you people to submit your papers at the earliest, so that we can make this webinar a fruitful discourse, and the interpretation part of it should be highlighted in their discourses. It can be, there is no binding on the volume of the presentations, because we cannot cover everything here in the online class, online webinars, because we have the time limitation. For that, I would like to regret that we will not be able to, we have not been able to accommodate all of you the way it should have been. But I am sure that all those things will be taken care of when we bring out the publication. So send your papers at the earliest, and at the end of it, I must request all the participants who have joined online to send their email. We have put our email ID in the chat box so that they can approach us for their to get the participation certificates who have attended the whole sessions. So at the end of today's webinar, may I thank our Honorable Chief Guest and our Honorable Member Secretary, Dr. Professor Sachidananda Joshi, who inaugurated this webinar and is always a source of inspiration for all of us. I must thank especially Dr. Prasad, instead of all his reservations with the online thing, who is doing the for the first time, he volunteered and proved it that age and the technology can be conquered by even a very, very senior citizen also. So he has done a great job in this. So I must thank all my young friends, Dr. Bevora, Dr. Gannaik, Dr. Sachin, Dr. Kumar, for being part of this webinar, and maybe in future also we will organize such things, and we will be organizing such things. At last and not the least, my thanks to Dr. Abhijit Dixit, who has made this webinar as very, very successful without any technical glitches. Thank you very much, Dr. Abhijit Dixit, and hope to bother you in future also.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you
very much to all. Thanks.